My name is Professor Shaheen Sharif. I'm an associate professor at McGill University. I always had an interest in the intersection of law and education. And so when I came to McGill, it was almost an automatic extension to look at cyberbullying. In the school context, in terms of the way we view traditional bullying, there's always an intent to harm. It's relentless and persistent, and there's a power imbalance. A lot of bullying is homophobic, it's sexist, it's racist, it's directed to kids who are overweight or have disabilities, or even gifted kids are targeted. Cyberbullying is different in that perpetrators can hide behind screen names. You know, they don't see the person face to face, and so it's easier to harm them. Spreading unfair rumors about people, or modifying photographs and distributing them. And the worst is, of course, spreading photographs of assault or beatings all over the internet. There are many, many factors that will cause people to engage in this kind of bullying. There might be neglect at home. There might be socioeconomic issues. There might be mental health issues. They may be rejected by teachers or ignored by teachers. Every situation is different.
Dr. Shaheen Sharif says it's a challenge most schools haven't figured out how to deal with.
It's a nightmare for schools.
Sharif says schools should get students involved in the fight against cyberbullying.
Engage the students in helping to develop their own codes of conduct in online use, because they are much more proficient, much more familiar with the internet.
The ultimate goal is to teach students that online bullying is just as hurtful as any other kind. Maya Johnson, CTV News.
It was mentioned that I'm interested in educating the legal community as well as the educational community, but one area that, you know, is critically important is health and emotional health, and emotional health of the kids, because both the victims and perpetrators, and they cross over, you know, perpetrators are often victims, and it's you folks that have to deal with the impact and the effects of it. So if my work on the legal issues and raising awareness among these kids about not only about the legal risks that they confront, hopefully that can, as well as that, we want to make them aware, obviously, of the impact and that they're having on people that they target. And we have to work with our young people to try and work out some kinds of boundaries, because what's happened is that the boundaries, the legal boundaries, have become blurred. Not only the legal boundaries, but the social norms online.
Shaheen Sharif, what do you think? I mean, you're wrapped up in awareness, education programs. Are more criminal charges the way to go?
No, Wendy, I don't think so at all. I'm concerned. I think that if we're going, you know, if we're going the criminal route, we have to be very careful of how we identify the perpetrators. There are two different types of perpetrators, as we saw in Amanda's case. There's an adult, there's the possible adult who may be involved in all the crimes that David described. But there are also younger kids who are also engaged in cyberbullying. And what we're finding in our research is that the norms of communication among digital natives, young people who are growing up immersed in technologies, are shifting in that they're focusing more on a competition and joking and not able to quite discern the harm between joking and teasing and where it crosses over to a criminal act or to defamation, you know, gossip and spreading of rumors. And in some U.S. cases, young people have testified that, you know, we were just having fun. It was just a joke. So what I believe is much more needs to be done to provide a legal literacy to young people, as well as really make them aware of what they to think about what they post.
But whose responsibility, Shaheen, is it if it is a criminal offense to call the alarms? Today it was kids who were reporting to the school. Is it the kids? Is it the parents? Is it Facebook?
I think it's anyone who knows about it. We're certainly encouraging young people to report it. They are reluctant to report it for fear of either being cyberbullied themselves or further harassment. And as the Supreme Court also acknowledged, that there is discernible harm. That's why victims want to remain anonymous, even if they want, you know, plan to sue their perpetrators. But in terms of anonymous reporting, I think we also have to be very careful there, because there's research that shows that perpetrators are also victims of cyberbullying and vice versa. So how, we need to be really sure that those anonymous reports are not being made by perpetrators against people they're already victimizing. So, it's going to be difficult. And just on the point of the proposed national strategy, I think that any national strategy, if it does go ahead, there need to be a lot more resources put into educating people.
Joining us now on Skype is McGill University Professor Shaheen Sharif, who's researching the legal boundaries involving cyberbullying and internet harassment. Welcome to the stream. Do you have a clear definition as to what bullying means, and is there even a distinction between cyberbullying and conventional bullying?
Yes, there is a difference between cyber and conventional bullying. So conventional bullying always involves a power imbalance. It's deliberate, it's relentless, it's intentional. And when it moves into cyberspace, it involves anonymity or perceived anonymity. It allows for the involvement of an infinite audience. And it can be saved and retrieved and passed on and distributed until it becomes quite viral.
So can it also amplify conventional bullying to then, when the person goes back into, for example, the schoolyard or the workplace, does it almost dovetail along with that and make it all the more worse?
Oh, yes, absolutely. There are examples of students who plan to beat others up on campus in the schoolyard, and that gets videotaped and posted on YouTube, and from there, it spreads rampantly. So, yes, it goes back and forth. And the issue is how it affects learning in the school context, as well as how it affects the school environment.
The question is it of epidemic proportions?
Well, I mean, epidemic in terms of, I wouldn't say it's epidemic, it's just that we hear more about it, it's reported more, and because digital media allow its proliferation so much, and there is more awareness of it, so we are hearing more and more about young people who are suffering this. Of course, we hear much more about the extreme cases where kids commit suicide, but, it goes on a daily basis, and a lot of kids don't report it.
Problem. Do you think criminalizing the issue might just exacerbate the situation, as I do? And I mean, that was my initial response. Is there even some sort of avenue to look at this legally?
We're experiencing the same thing in Canada, because our parliament has also tabled legislation to amend the criminal code to make cyberbullying a criminal offense. And it's a big concern for us. That is not the way to go. We found in our research that these reactive measures absolutely don't work. And exactly as you say, are we going to put younger and younger students in jail, and for what? We found that even in the schools, the response is to suspend kids instead of engaging in dialogue with them. And we've developed a website where we want to educate policymakers as well as parents, educators, and even the corporate media, and on how to engage with the kids in talking about these issues, because kids are reluctant to report it. They need to understand how and when they make ethical decisions to engage in this, that it could have legal ramifications.
Yeah.
If I may just continue for one second, what we're finding is that the digital natives, as they're known, the kids growing up immersed in digital media, we find that they're having difficulty deciding between jokes and harmless teasing and entertainment that has legal consequences. And this is what we need to make them aware of.
It's a tougher job dealing with society's deeper, complex issues, isn't it? I mean, in a way, children are caricatures of what their parents think. They provide a microcosm. The schoolyard, and for that matter, 15-year-olds talking to each other on Facebook provide a microcosm of some of society's more disturbing issues quite often. Is there the appetite and the societal and maybe even political will to deal with that and to look at bullying in that deeper sense and not just look at it from a rotten apple perspective?
I think there is. I think, you know, it was mentioned, Dana Boyd's work was mentioned, and John Palfrey at Harvard. There are a number of people who are doing very good research, and lawyers as well, who are advocating against criminalizing these issues. And it's not just criminal law that's involved. For example, when the kids engage in gossip on social media, that can involve defamation, so it can involve private law. Legal liability, where people can be sued for what they say online. There are also issues of freedom of expression, and how do you balance free expression, safety, supervision, and regulation online? Mm-hmm. And there are age-appropriate issues involved. It is complex, and we, you know, there are a range of responses that can be addressed. But ultimately, it's all about making the young people aware, of the legal risks.